Last few months, we've been working our way through the Gospel of Matthew. And this morning's Gospel reading is from the 25th chapter. It's known as the parable of the 10 bridesmaids. Jesus said the kingdom of heaven will be like this. 10 bridesmaids took their lamps and went out to meet the bridegroom. 5 of them were foolish, 5 were wise. When the foolish took their lamps, they took no oil with them. The wise took flasks of oil with their lamps. As the bridegroom was delayed, all of them became drowsy and slept. But at midnight, there was a shout, "Look, the bridegroom, come out to meet him." And all those bridesmaids got up and trimmed their lamps. The foolish said to the wise, "Give us some of your oil, our lamps are going out." But the wise replied, "No, there won't be enough for you and for us. You'd better go to the dealers and buy some yourselves." While they went out to buy it, the bridegroom came. Those who were ready went with him into the wedding banquet, and the door was shut. Later, the other bridesmaids came also, saying, "Lord, Lord, open to us." But he replied, "Truly, I tell you, I do not know you. Keep awake, therefore, for you know neither the day nor the hour." This morning we have baptism, this reading from the Gospel, the parable of the 10 bridesmaids, and then Eucharist. Now, not that I'm an astrologist by any stretch, but this is a most remarkable alignment of the stars. In terms of our understanding of the parable, let's recognize at the start that there is something in the human heart, and sadly, something in the Church of Jesus Christ, that is inclined towards judgment, to the settling of scores. Maybe 6, maybe 8 weeks ago, Drew did a brilliant job contrasting revenge and forgiveness. He started out with the box office smash hits, all of them based on revenge. Russell Crowe as Gladiator, Mel Gibson as the Patriot, Liam Neeson as that unstoppable father in Taken. And we love those movies because we love to see the good guys settle the scores and the bad guys get their due. There's something in us that loves retributive justice, that the good get rewarded and the bad pay. It's neat. It's tidy. It helps us feel safe and secure as long as we're confident that we're on God's good side. The thing is, fair is not gospel. It's not good news. It's not good news because if we are weighed in the balance, we each are found wanting. If we got what was fair, we'd all be in big trouble. The Apostle Paul put it bluntly, all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. And if by chance you don't feel like you missed the mark, why don't you have a word with your spouse or your partner? Ask them what they think. It may be that they don't have any difficulty pointing out a few things that you're inclined to overlook. Again, we don't have any trouble understanding, believing in retributive justice. It comes natural, that sense that the good should be rewarded and the bad should be punished. Where we struggle is to get our heads around reconciling grace, to understand that Jesus takes away the sin of the world, the sin of the whole wide world, everything and everyone in it. All have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. But God proves his love for us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. That's the good news. We struggle with that because it doesn't take very long in discussion before the same questions come up as they always do. What about Hitler? What about the serial child molester? What about my mother-in-law? We want retributive justice. We want our own Nuremberg trial. These bounders need to pay for their sin. Now, my mother-in-law actually isn't that bad. Close, but not bad. Put things on pause for just a moment. The word judgment, as in the last judgment, is the word krisis in New Testament Greek. We get the word crisis from that same word. Crisis. Decision time. Choice and consequence. It's like Morpheus says in The Matrix. This is your last chance. After this, there's no turning back. Take the blue pill. The story ends. You wake up in your bed, you believe whatever you want to believe. Take the red pill, you stay in Wonderland, and I'll show you how deep the rabbit hole goes. Crisis. Blue pill, red pill. In the parable of the 10 bridesmaids, it's a 50-50 split. Half of them take the blue pill. They stay in their beds. The door gets shut. They don't get welcomed into Wonderland. Now, before you panic, let's plod slowly here. First of all 10 bridesmaids go out to meet the bridegroom. From the very beginning, there is this gracious inclusion. All 10 of them. The smart ones and the dumb ones. Doesn't matter. All 10 of them are dressed in hideous gowns that they will never, ever wear anywhere else as long as they live. Now, that's why we baptized Tessa Rose this morning. Not the hideous gowns piece. As far as God's concerned, we are all included. We're all invited. We are all welcome. Well before any of us know who will end up smart and who will make dumb decisions in their lives, before there's any question of merit, before anything of what we deserve, whether we'll be good or bad, as far as God is concerned, we are all welcome. We're all in, because it's not about us. It's about Jesus, and he's taken away the sin of the world, ours included, Tessa Rose's, each and every one of us. Jesus has taken our sin. So what about the 5 foolish bridesmaids in the gospel parable? Why did the door get closed on them? Why wasn't the door left wide open so that they could join the festivities, late though they may have been? What about better late than never? Just so you know, that's not gospel, better late than never. There's crisis. Decision time. Choice and consequence. Each one of us makes choices that determines the course of our lives. And a child who doesn't understand that, who doesn't understand that their choices have consequences, they're spoiled, they're indulged, they're an undisciplined brat. And an adult who doesn't understand that their choices have consequence is a walking train wreck. But our life choices are made within the embrace of God's acceptance and inclusion. Nobody earns anything. Nobody achieves anything. There's nothing here about good works, about deserving God's kindness, God's favor. Quite the opposite. The wise bridesmaids, really, they're a pretty snarky lot. They're selfish. They weren't willing to share. That doesn't sound very Christian at all. Sounds like they have a scarcity mentality, that there won't be enough. And the foolish bridesmaids, they were trying to problem solve, to make things right, to get themselves sorted. They don't get any credit whatsoever for all of their efforts. It's really rather confusing till we drill down beneath the surface. This isn't the only parable of crisis, parable of judgment. There are others. They all underline the same thing. Those who end up on the outside were on the inside from the very beginning. The man with the wedding garment, without a wedding garment rather, was just as much an accepted guest as all the others who walked in off the street. The servant who buried the master's gold was trusted just as much as the other two who made smart investments. Both the sheep and the goats lived out their lives under the authority of the king and in the presence of the least of their brothers and sisters. As topsy-turvy as all these parables seem, the 10 bridesmaids included, there's a call to faith in the mystery of grace. And the exercise of faith matters. And it matters eternally. Choice and consequence, blue pill, red pill. Now, to be crystal clear, faith is not simply intellectual assent to a set of propositions. The baptismal questions. Do you turn to Jesus Christ and accept Him as your Savior? Do you put your whole trust in His grace and His love? Do you promise to obey Him as your Lord? Our answers to those questions are life changers. They mean that we live out a trust relationship with Jesus, in Jesus, day by day, week by week, year by year. What we believe in our heads, we live out with our hands and our feet and our hearts. Try this. For those of you visiting, my wife's name is Carrie. And if I ask the question, does Carrie love me? I can very easily make propositional assent. No doubt, I believe that Carrie loves me. Now the big question, what do I do with that love? How do I respond to it? How do I live my life in relationship with this woman who loves me? She's an amazing woman, so and in so many ways. She loves me, but I could choose to ignore that love. I could live completely indifferent to her love. I could take advantage of her love and simply use her to meet my needs. Instead of spending my free time with her, I could go golfing every chance I got. All of that would be really dumb because I have the honor and the privilege of responding to her love with love. I get to reciprocate her love. I get to love her back. I take all of that to infinity and beyond. Jesus loves us. He loves each and every one of us. the big question. What do we do with His love? How do we respond to it? How do we live our lives in relationship to Him and that love? That's the life of faith. Jesus, the bridegroom, has invited us to His wedding banquet. Each and every one of us, wise and foolish, good and bad. What do we do with the invitation? Because if we're invited to the party, we ought to act like we're in a party. See if this helps. Jesus told another parable about a father's love. Love he had for two sons. One of his boys grossly abused that love, completely squandered it, made a total and absolute wreck of his life, but eventually dragged his sorry self back home, only to be greeted with open arms, full restoration, and a no-expense party to celebrate his return. Food, wine, music, dancing. And his older brother, who'd never given his father a moment's grief, he stands outside of this shindig. And he asks, what is all of this about? There's a party going on, and he's not having any of it. The father in the parable comes out and says this, my son, you are always with me, and all that I have is yours. But how could we fail to celebrate this happy day? Your brother was dead. He's come back to life. He was lost. Now he's found. It's crisis time. Blue pill, red pill. The older brother is either going to stay grumpy and insist on retributive justice, wishing that his deadbeat younger brother gets the full fury of his father's wrath. If so, he stays on the outside. He excludes himself. It's a really dumb choice because there's a party going on. But at the party, no grumps are allowed. No party poopers are welcomed in. He either gets happy or he stays out. That's the gospel. Tax collectors, prostitutes, they come to Jesus and he welcomes them gladly. The unclean, the adulterer come and Jesus receives him. The thief with his dying breath, the thief on the cross turns to Jesus and asks for mercy and Jesus assures him that together they will be in paradise. The last, the lost, the loose, the loser, they come to Jesus. And no one is refused because Jesus is infinite in mercy, ready to forgive all and every sin, every amount of wickedness. But here in the parable of the bridesmaids, the door is shut. How can that be? Why is it that half the wedding party get locked out? Why would Jesus ever shut the door on anybody? Because the Bible is a book of mercy. Aaron the high priest was received after his idolatry. King David was restored after his adultery and murder. Disciple Peter reconciled after denouncing Jesus three times. We back it all up, Peter, David, Aaron, the thief on the cross, the unclean, the tax collector, the prostitute. They each turned to the Lord. They humbled themselves. They asked for mercy. They asked for mercy, they received the Lord's forgiveness, and they got happy. We'll soon be celebrating Eucharist. That's the Greek word for thanksgiving. We will be celebrating with thanksgiving. We celebrate and we give thanks because we have asked for mercy. We have received the Lord's forgiveness. We celebrate, give thanks that God has proved His love for us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. We celebrate and give thanks this morning because the Holy Spirit is purposing here and now, today, to restore our lives, to heal, to bless. We're invited to celebrate the joy of our salvation. It's a choice that we each make. Here in the parable, after the door's been shut, the bridegroom says to the late coming bridesmaids, "I do not know you." Eugene Peterson, in his paraphrase, The Message, put it this way. Do I know you? I don't think I know you. This knowing is to be reciprocal. When Jesus says, I do not know you, he's also saying, you don't know me. All this makes me think of the story of an old rabbi who repeatedly would say, make sure you repent the day before your death. Finally, somebody said, but rabbi, who knows the day of their death? And the rabbi said, exactly. God bless you.